Welcome everybody to our crib service today, and I'm delighted that we're going to also have some of the Adventurers Sunday Club children taking part in today's service. It's great to welcome all of you online on this Christmas Eve, or if you're watching this after Christmas Eve, during the season of Christmas. And we begin by singing our first carol together. Now the children who are involved in doing poems and readings and songs for this service have also done a separate service where the readings and poems and prayers have come together with a play, which is available also on our YouTube channel. And I want to pay tribute to Elena and all the parents and the children in their work in creating this drama, which I recommend you watch. During this crib service, we're just going to be hearing the readings and the songs and the music from the earlier part of that production. But first of all, I'm going to open up that demonstration of the videos that they've created with a little introduction to Elena herself, followed by a Christmas greeting by Emily.
It was on a starry night, when the hills were bright, Earth lay sleeping, sleeping calm and still. And in a cattle shed, in a manger bed, a boy was born, King of all the world. And the angels sang for him, the bells of heaven rang for him, for a boy was born, King of all the world. So the shepherds came that way, where the baby lay, and were kneeling, kneeling by his side. And the hearts believed again, for the peace of men. For a boy was born, King of all the world.
Thank you very much, Emily. Now I'm wondering who can tell me who was in the crib first. Who was in the crib, first of all? Who was the first to be in the crib? I'll tell you who it was. It was the animals. The animals were first of all in the crib. And so, while we're singing this next carol, I'm going to go and put the animals in the crib.
Thank you.
Here we have the crib underneath the altar, and there you see we have animals. What sort of animal is it on the left, do you think? It's a cow. And what sort of animal is on the right, do you think? It's a donkey. I don't know if you can see that, okay, but we have the crib in the middle of the church and surrounded by the church, which is looking beautiful. We've got the Christmas tree. We've got the flowers on the walls, flowers over there, and some figures right at the far end of the church. I don't know if you can see who they are. They're right up by the east end because that's where they came from, but I'll come to that next. We're now going to hear a reading called Winter by Oscar from our Children's Sunday Adventurers Club.
Winter, when icicles hang by the wall and Dick the shepherd blows his nail and Tom bears logs into the hall and milk comes frozen home in pail. When blood is nipped and ways to be foul, the nightly things are staring out, trip to woo a merry note while greasy Joan doth kill the pot. When all aloud the wind doth blow, coffin drowns the parson's saw, and birds sit brooding in the snow, and Martian's nose looks red and raw. When roasted crabs hiss in the bowl, the nightly sings the staring owl, twit to woo a merry note while greasy Joan doth kill the pot.
Thank you very much, Oscar. So we've got the animals in the crib, and the animals being in the crib is very important because, as I say, it shows the importance of animals. Animals are very important to God. Animals have been great companions, haven't they, during this year where many of us have been having to live at home. For those of you who are blessed with pets, they've been a great comfort. I wonder if you have a pet. Do you have a dog or a cat or a guinea pig or a rabbit? Or do you have friends who've got pets? They are great supports. We have had at our home a puppy who we got in February. And his name is Ben. And he has been a lot of hard work because he is a chocolate Labrador. And he is still very much a puppy, even though he's over 1 year old. You might see that I do not have my dog collar on. That is because Ben chewed my last dog collar yesterday, and I have been unable to find one in order to wear for this service. But never mind, I'm still pleased to be with you. And I imagine normally this church would be full on a Christmas Eve, full of people all around. Here today, it does feel just a little empty, shall we say, but let's not worry. So after the animals, who came next? Would you like to try answering that at home? Who came next to the crib? Was it the shepherds? Was it the angels? Can't hear you. Did someone there watching say Mary and Joseph? If you did, you're right. Well done. Well, we're going to sing our next carol while I go and fetch Mary and Joseph.
Oh, Well, here is Mary on the left and Joseph on the right. They had arrived at Bethlehem and they were waiting for Jesus to be born. It must have been very cold in the stable, mustn't it? But God was with them and he was watching over them. I'm sure they must have been a bit apprehensive, as people this year have been apprehensive, worried about where their life is going. Maybe some of you watching today are a little bit worried. But with faith, we can learn to trust in God, no matter what. And my prayer is that you will be able to trust in God, no matter what the future holds. Because faith is based not just on what's happening on the surface of life, but on our own inner being and our own inner spirituality.
So, we're now going to hear Leah singing Silent Night, and then Elliot reading A Song Was Heard at Christmas.
Silent night, holy night, all is calm, all is bright, round yon virgin mother and child. Holy infant, so tender and mild, sleep in heavenly peace. Sleep in heavenly peace.
A song was heard at Christmas, a song was heard at Christmas, to wake the midnight sky, a Saviour's birth, and peace on earth, and praise is to God on high. The angels sang at Christmas with all the hosts above, and still we sing the newborn King, his glory and his love.
Thank you very much to Elliot and to Leah for their singing and reading. Well, who came next? Was it the wise men? Was it the innkeeper, maybe, to see how they were? Was it the shepherds? I'll tell you who came next. Jesus came next. Jesus was the next to arrive in the crib because Mary gave birth to Jesus. And while I go and fetch Jesus and put him in the cradle, we're going to sing our next carol.
Oh,
Well, there is baby Jesus in the manger, having just been born. Mary and Joseph were so pleased. The birth of Jesus brings God's presence into the world in a new way, because Christians have always believed that Jesus was not just a human being, but the second person of the Trinity, God incarnate. It's a mystery and a mystical theology which deserves a lot of study. But basically, through Jesus, we can discover what God is like. That he is love, light, friendship, forgiveness, and purpose in so many ways. Discovering Jesus in our lives makes all the difference in the challenges that we face at this time and in future. So now, Poppy is going to sing Jingle Bells, and then Sienna is going to say the poem When Santa Got Stuck Up the Chimney.
Jingle bell, little the way, all the fun to one.
In a one horse.
Play. Hey, jingle bell, they all the way. All the fun to one, the wonderful day. Hey!
When Santa got stuck up the chimney, he began to shout, "You girls and boys won't get any toys if you don't pull me out. My beard is black, there's soot in my sack. My nose is tickly too." When Santa got stuck up the chimney, achoo, achoo, achoo.
Thank you very much to Sienna and to Poppy for those beautiful readings and singing. Well, I think you'll get this next one. Who came next? I'm not going to give you any clues. I'll give you one clue though, actually, why not? It wasn't the wise men. So who does that leave? The shepherds, that's right, well done.
Fear not, says he, for my
Here we have the shepherds. Beautifully made, aren't they? We're not sure how old these figures are, but they are very, very unique. And they've been used at our crib services for many years. I think the shepherds also represent the hard workers of this world. And while I think of hard workers, I'm thinking of all those this year who've worked so hard in our hospitals and in our surgeries, in the ambulance work, in the mental health work, all those who've worked so hard behind the scenes to keep our country going. People who work on the front line in shops, we also remember today. And I also want us to remember in our prayers the Prime Minister, the leader of the opposition, and our politicians who get a bad press but have been working extremely hard, just like these shepherds would have been working. So these shepherds represent the hard-working people of the world. And I'm sure that you're, as you watch this, some of you parents are amongst that.
So, next out of the young people is Dorcas, who's going to present It Was the Night Before Christmas.
It was the night before Christmas when all through the house not a creature was stirring, not even a mouse. The stockings were hung by the chimney with care, in hope that St. Nicholas soon would be there. The children were nestled all snug in their beds, while visions of sugar plums danced in their heads. And Mama in her kerchief and I in my cap had just settled our brains for a long winter's nap. When out on the lawn there arose such a clatter, I sprang from my bed to see what was the matter. Away to the window I flew like a flash, tore open the shutters and threw back the sash. The moon on the breast of the new-fallen snow had a lustre of midday to objects below, when what to my wondering eyes did appear but a miniature sleigh and 8 tiny reindeer, with a little old driver so lively and quick, I knew it in a moment. He must be St. Nick. More rapid than eagles, his course they came, and his whistle and shout and called them by name. Now Dasher, now Dancer, now Prancer and Vixen, on Comet, on Cupid, on Donner and Blitzen, to the top of the porch, to the top of the wall. Now dash away, dash away, dash away all. As leaves that before the wild hurricane fly, when they met with an obstacle, mount to the sky. So up to the household, the courses they flew, with the sleigh full of toys, and St. Nicholas too. And then in a twinkling I heard on the roof the prancing and pawing of each little hoof. As I drew in my head and was turning around, down the chimney St. Nicholas came with a bound. He was dressed all in fur from his head to his foot, and his clothes were all tarnished with ashes and soot. A bundle of toys he'd flung on his back, and he looked like a peddler just opening his pack. His eyes, how they twinkled, his dimples, how merry. His cheeks were like roses, his nose like a cherry. His droll little mouth was drawn up like a bow, and the beard on his chin was as white as the snow. The stump of a pipe he had tight in his teeth, and the smoke it encircled his head like a wreath. He had a broad face and a little round belly that shook when he laughed like a bowl full of jelly. He was chubby and plump, a right jolly old elf, and I laughed when I saw him, in spite of myself. A wink of his eye and a twist of his head soon gave me to know I had nothing to dread. He spoke not a word, but he went straight to his work and filled all the stockings, then turned with a jerk, and laying his finger aside from his nose and giving a nod, up the chimney he rose. He sprang to his sleigh, his team gave a whistle, and away they all flew like the down of a thistle. But I heard him explain, ere he drove out of sight, "Happy Christmas to all, and to all a good night." Merry Christmas, everybody!
Thank you very much, Dorcas. So I'm sure you're going to get the last one. Who came next to the crib? We've got Jesus, we've got Mary and Joseph, we've got the shepherds. But who came next? Say it a bit louder. A bit louder. Yes, that's right. It was the three kings, but also called the wise men. They had come from the east. We don't know where they came from, but they were attracted by a star in the sky. And they believed this meant the new king was to be born soon. So they made their journey towards Bethlehem and arrived, and they brought three gifts: gold, frankincense, and myrrh.
Thank you.
Here we have two of the kings, and the other one is over here. They actually arrived on January the 6th, which we call the Epiphany. But I like to have them in the crib on Christmas Eve as well. And then they go back again, just because they're so important to children. They came from a different culture. And that again shows the importance of Christmas, bringing people from different backgrounds together. They represent generosity. And while they were there, it was as if the whole place filled with light.
Thank you.
peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you all evermore. Amen.
In the land of Israel, there was once a prophet called Jonah. He was a good and righteous man. He did not like seeing people arguing or fighting, and would always try to settle the fight by teaching them about God.
This is my pot.
No, it's mine. I saw it first.
No, I did. I need it to carry water.
I need it to carry raisins.
Stop! Fighting never solves anything. Besides, you are making me dizzy, my friends. Please, God doesn't want you fighting. It upsets him. Fighting is what the people of Nineveh do. Do you want God to think we are just like the Ninevites?
Oh no. Jonah, we are sorry. The Ninevites are enemies of our people.
So Jonah's task was to teach people about God's laws and his love. But there came a day when God had an even bigger job for Jonah.
Jonah, the people of Nineveh are not obeying my laws. They steal. They are not kind to each other. They are lazy and selfish. The children of Nineveh do not take care of their older people. And their king pretends not to see the problems. All he cares about is eating all day and long and wearing fancy clothes and jewels. This is not right. I cannot accept it.
God, it is true. The Ninevites are very bad people. They have been evil to my people too. God, send them a flood or an earthquake to punish them.
Listen, Jonah. They are bad because they do not know me. No one has taught them about me or my laws. So I've decided to send you, Jonah. Go to Nineveh and teach them about me and my ways, the way you teach the Israelites. Tell the Ninevites about my love, then ask them to repent and stay away from wrongdoing for good, if they want to be spared from my punishment.
My God, it is really so nice to hear your voice. But God, go to Nineveh and be good to the enemies of my friends and neighbours. I cannot do that. Please give me some other job.
Jonah, you must go right now and tell them of my love. Then, and only then, warn them that in 40 days, if they do not repent and change to be better people, I will punish them for all their wrongdoings.
Jonah was confused. He really did not want to go to Nineveh. This was such a big problem. If he did not go, the Ninevites would the Ninevites he would disobey God, but if he did, he would be letting all his people, the Israelites, down. In the end, he decided to hide away from God by running as far away from Nineveh as possible. So he went to the seaside town of Joppa and found a boat that was going to sail for
Tarshish,
a city on the other side of the world. He paid the fare and went aboard the ship.
But James should have known better. When you are dealing with God, you can run all you like, but you can't hide. God knew exactly where Jonah was, so he sent terrible wind on the sea and a violent storm.
Captain, I have never seen a storm like that. We are in trouble.
Take down the sails.
The storm tossed around the ship and threatened to break it. The sailors were very scared.
Help, this is awful, the worst storm ever.
Throw everything overboard so we don't sink.
They threw the cargo into the sea to lighten the ship load, but it was no help.
What about the gods? Quick, let us pray to our gods.
Then each of them kneeled and prayed to their gods, made from stone and clay, but the storm just grew stronger.
Hey, where's that guy? You know the guy from Joppa who is running away from his god?
The captain was looking for Jonah. He found him taking a snooze below deck.
How can you sleep? The crew cast lots and found that you are the reason we have been dealt such bad luck at sea. Get up right away and call on your god. Maybe he will take notice of us and spare us from this terrible storm.
The captain made him come up and confess who he was to all the sailors.
I'm an Israelite, and I worship the one and only God Almighty of heaven and earth. I'm running away from him because he has sent me to my enemies. He wants me to teach them about him and his love, and I don't want to do that. The storm means that he has found me. I was foolish to think I can run away or hide from God. I am so sorry to have brought you this trouble. The only way to stop the storm is for you to throw me overboard into the sea. It really is the only way.
The sailors were sad about this idea. They tried throwing other things off the ship instead, but the storm kept rising, and in the end Jonah persuaded them to throw him overboard, so they did. Immediately the sea waters calmed down and the sun came up.
Don't worry, everybody. Of course God did not let anything bad happen to Jonah. He sent a big whale that gulped Jonah right down into his tummy. Jonah didn't like the rotten fish smells inside, but he was safe in there for 3 days and three nights. While he was in the fish's tummy, with not much to do, Jonah spent all of his time talking to God.
Hey there, God, it's so dark and stinky down here, and I'm so lost somewhere at the bottom of the sea. I'm really sorry for trying to hide and run away from you. I'm sorry for bringing trouble to the sailors who let me sail with them.
Thank you for sparing them and saving their ship. I know I can always talk to you out loud or in my prayer thoughts, and I know that you hear me always. As I sit here in the humongous belly of this whale, I finally understand how important it is to obey you and do the task that you've sent me to do. I promise to be true and obey you. Please spare me. I love you so much. Thank you for everything.
Oh. Narrator? Emily?
Right then, the fish opened his mouth and spat Jonah back out into the dry land, as if you might expect God spoke to Jonah again.
Jonah, this time, do what I tell you. Go, get up and go to Nineveh and tell the people of that great city about me and my love. Ask them to turn away from their wrongdoing and ask me for forgiveness. Ask them to better their ways, smarten up and become good people, because if they don't, I will punish them.
This time, Jonah did what he was told and went straight to Nineveh. It was a long way. When he got there, he did what he was told.
Hey, you people from Nineveh! I'm sent here from the Almighty God of heaven and earth to tell you about his great ways and his love. He's extremely unhappy with you. He's seen all your wrongdoings and misbehaving, but he has sent me to give you one last chance to repent and be saved. I am to warn you that if you don't listen and change, in 40 days, Nineveh will be destroyed. This is what the Lord is telling you. You don't have to steal from each other, because you're all brothers and sisters in this world. Would you steal from your family? You shouldn't hurt anyone who's weaker than you, because we're all children of God, and we should instead protect each other. You should take care of your elders, because they helped raise you and look after you. God gave this wonderful world to us, and we have to look after it well. Be kind to one another and love God.
Jonah.
Warning. Not only did the people listen, but it even reach the king of Nineveh.
Today I issue this proclamation with a royal decree. Do not let people or animals, herds or flock, eat or drink anything, but let people and animals express how deeply sorry they are by covering themselves with sackcloth. Let everyone call urgently on God. Let them give up their evil ways and their violence. Let us all repent and ask for God's forgiveness, so that in his love and compassion, he would spare us and be our God forever and ever.
Everyone in Nineveh was sorry, even the
sheep and cows and dogs and cats and mice.
When God saw all
this, God
forgave
them and
decided
not to
destroy the city after all.
Meanwhile, Jonah was getting ready to watch God punish all the enemies of his people from a hill above Nineveh.
Jonah, well done, my dear son. I am really proud of you. The Ninevites have now truly repented and changed their ways, and I have forgiven them.
Such bad people. Why are we still going to punish them?
They have heard my voice through you, Jonah. Don't forget, they are my children just like you. The Israelites and all people are my children too. I love them just like I love all of you.
Oh no, I was afraid this might happen. This is why I ran away, God. And I saved the enemies of my people. What a tragedy.
It is right to be angry, Jonah. Go home. All will be okay.
This new turn of events made Jonah really cross, confused and unhappy. He didn't want to know what to do with himself or where to go. The desert was terribly hot and he did not have any food or drink with him. But God continued to look after Jonah. God made a big plant grow up over him. It was kind of like a pumpkin plant with a great wide shady leaves like umbrellas. Jonah liked it and was very grateful to have felt quite comfy and safe in the shade of a plant God sent. But the next morning, God sent along a worm, chewed up the plant and killed it. The day became hot and Jonah thought he would die from the heat without the shade of his friend, the green plant.
I'm so sad. My friend, Mr. Green Plant, is gone.
Jonah, what right do you have to be angry about the plant?
I have every right to be angry.
Jonah, this plant grew in one night and disappeared the next. You didn't do anything for it, and you didn't make it grow, yet you feel sorry for it. Now, tell me how much more, then, should I have mercy and give my forgiveness on Nineveh, that great city? There are more than 120,000 innocent children in it, and as well as many animals.
The way Jonah felt about the plant was sort of like how God felt about all the people of Nineveh and all of the animals too. He loved them all very much, and if they all showed how sorry they were and turned away from wrongdoing, God is ready to forgive. The people of Nineveh had learned the lesson God wanted them to learn, and so did Jonah and all of us hearing this story.
The end. Amazing. That was absolutely amazing. Well done.